I'm Jenny Brockie. Tonight on Insight, changing a mindset. Can it be done and does it last?
Well, I was totally believing the whole time I was there, and I never wanted to leave. I mean, I believe I was under mind control.
It's a very controversial area as to whether mind control really exists.
Welcome, everybody. Good to have you with us tonight. Yeon-mi, I wanted to talk to you first because until 7 years ago, you lived in North Korea.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
What sort of power did you believe that Kim Jong-il had over you, the then leader had over you?
They said he's got a, like, almighty power. So I thought just he can read my mind all the time. So I could not even think about in my mind he's bad. You know,
so what if you started thinking he was bad, what would you do? And how would you feel if you had those thoughts?
I could not imagine. It was too terrifying to think about him as a bad person and or bad leader because he's the like captain of this earth.
What did you think would happen to you if you had bad thoughts about him?
Maybe I can be killed by...
Be killed?
Yeah, just police. Yeah. I thought just he knows everything, so I could not even think about any, you know.
And did you know of people who'd been killed for having bad thoughts about him?
Yeah, it's like one of my best friends, her mom, saw some like American dramas or like South Korean dramas, and then she got caught, and then they decide to like give her the like punishment as a like public execution. So I went there with her, my friends, and then
this was to see your friend's mother executed.
Yes, like public execution in the like big stadium. Like I must be there. It's like I need to.
So it was expected of you to be there.
Yeah. So like if I don't go there, they check my name, and you know, so it can be a big problem.
How old were you when that happened?
I was 11. And I was with my friends, that was her mother, and I was like closing my eyes at that time, but I could not even cry.
And you couldn't be sad, you couldn't be upset.
Yeah, because...
Because if you think that the leader can read your mind, you can't do anything.
Mm-hmm.
And you've described your teenage years in North Korea as not being able to see, smell or hear.
Yeah.
What do you mean by that?
I was like being completely... No sense on my body. I could not, even though I see the something, I cannot see really what it exactly is. And then I did not know the any truth because I thought just North Korea is the main country in the world and that we were the best country and all the people was envious, you know, and I was like, no, I had no idea at the time. Just I could not even think really.
You were 14 when you left.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Tom, during the 1990s, you were the leader of one of the most feared and violent neo-Nazi groups in Norway. Tell me about your core beliefs, what you believed during that time.
Well, it was extreme ideology, focusing on a Jewish world conspiracy. And we actually did believe that the world was under Jewish control and that they wanted to mix the races and exterminate the white race, my race, as I looked at it.
Were you solely focused on Jewish people for your hatred, or did you hate other people as well?
So we hated, truly hated people with other skin color than white. To be quite honest, I'm sorry to say, but especially when you look at the people from Africa, black Africans, we didn't even consider them human. We looked at them as subhuman, as we compared them, not to laugh about it, as a neo-Nazi, we didn't laugh about it, but we did compare them with monkeys, that they had no capabilities like we, the white people, have to create technology, to feel empathy. We looked at them as animals.
And what sort of violent things did you do on that basis?
No, we would, by chance, attack people who we believed were anti-racist or leftists. We hated them even more than we hated people of color. But if we saw colored people, we could attack them too.
How violent were you?
Well, the most serious case was a stabbing, which I did not do the stabbing, but a person was 1 millimeter from dying when he was stabbed in the back with a knife from the main artery.
Were you there?
Yes, yes, I was a part of
it. Did you support it at the time?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
What happened?
And I motivated it. The guy who we stabbed, he was the owner of a gun store, which we, at very short notice, decided that we wanted to rob. That was out of paranoia. We actually did believe that the UN would attack Norway and, you know...
The UN was going to attack Norway.
Yeah, so we needed guns quickly. So it was, it was like we were living on another planet.
Good Lord. And you used to carry a Glock pistol around with you?
Well, the thing with the Glock was that when I was in Oslo, I was attacked a few times. I was stabbed with knife and I was hit in the back of my head with beer bottles. And the back of my head, I have a huge tattoo now, but if you look closely, it's like a European map. It's I had a lot of stitches in my head because I was often attacked when I was in Oslo because I would, I wasn't afraid of who I was. I would always show it.
You looked like a neo-Nazi.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I had like a swastika fetish, you know. I had swastikas on every piece of clothing I had. Even I had a boxer shorts with tiny swastikas. So, you know, I was all into the swastika and I would always wear that to show people who I was. And I would have a big bunch of pamphlets also to give out.
So you were a hardcore neo-Nazi in Norway.
Yes.
Levena, you're 15 and you were born into a commune called the 12 Tribes near Sydney. What sort of rules were there when you were growing up?
There were so many aspects to it. Like, you're not allowed to have toys and you're not allowed to talk to any kids. And if you are there, you get punished. You get disciplined, like, at least 2 or 3 times a day.
How were you disciplined?
They use like a rod and it's like, yes, a rod.
And what sort of things would you get that for?
Really tiny things, like if you didn't come, like if someone said, oh, come here, and you didn't come straight away. Yeah, they didn't allow any like imagining things and you're not allowed to ride bikes or anything.
But you're not allowed to imagine?
Yeah, like imagine things like play babies and like stuff like that, and they don't tell the kids about like fairies and all that sort of stuff, like Santa. It's all not allowed and stuff.
Okay, so no sort of fantasizing about things at all.
Yeah.
You got hit once for taking an extra piece of fruit. Is that right? Is that right?
Yeah. It was funny. I remember I got disciplined by like 3 other people, just for that. And then like for the rest of like the days going on, I was like looked down on and like shamed upon, like. Yeah.
How did you view the outside world when you were in this commune?
They made it out to be like the work of Satan, and so I was actually really scared of the outside world.
Did you have much to do with the outside world?
No, not at all. Like, we weren't allowed to watch anything, and we're never allowed to listen to radio, anything like that.
Did you go to school?
No, not public school. We had a training person who was in charge. Like, they have their own curriculum. It's like more strict, and they have religious things as well.
Who did you trust?
You can't really trust anyone there. It's like the whole thing's like a snitching thing. So like even husbands and wives, like you can't even trust them.
What do you mean a snitching thing?
I don't know, like they tell on you, like.
So did you trust your mum?
I couldn't really even have a relationship with my mum.
Rose, you're Lebanese mum. What was it like for you as a parent in this group?
Well, my motherhood totally changed. It was as part of my whole life was taken. It wasn't mine anymore. I mean, I believe I was under mind control when I was there.
Like mind control?
Yes, what I signed up to, what I really believed, the message that was preached, that we're going to change the world and bringing a new age of peace where God reigns and all this, and we're going to be free to worship God the way we want. We're just going to get a bit of help. And
how thoroughly did you believe all that?
Well, totally believing the whole time I was there, and I never wanted to leave. For 13 years that I was in the 12 tribes cult here, so I totally believed everything.
And did you hit Lebanon for these sorts of things she was talking
yes.
about?
Well, before I never hit my children, never ever. I never received any physical punishment myself growing up, and I never believed that the children needed that. But I did agree. I knew that when I joined, I would have to apply certain measures, and that involved discipline. I was already under mind control when I started realizing, wow, this is a lot.
When you say mind control, what do you mean by mind control?
I say mind control, but really it's your whole life, your emotions, your mind, your body, your time, everything comes under the control of the leader, really, the top leader, and his perception of the world and how you should live out your faith. And so you're not free to live out your faith. Because everything's told, you know, you get told how to do everything. And
Louise, you're a clinical psychologist with a particular interest in these sorts of situations. How wedded do people become to these sorts of beliefs, or can they become to these sorts of beliefs? Because from the outside, you know, it seems so extreme, but how readily are people sort of sucked into it?
If people are at a particular point in their life when they're particularly vulnerable, then pretty well anybody can be subjected to quite a sophisticated psychological process where they can come to believe things that they otherwise would not necessarily believe. And the key to it is that they are appealing to some very basic human needs, and that's for purpose and meaning in life. So that basic need in people is really what people are seduced by. And if you add to that the fact that a lot of these techniques are designed to change your level of arousal in a way that dampens down your capacity to think critically, you then start to control different aspects of a person's life, then the more you start to control people's behaviour, the more you start to control the way they feel. And that's often not really well understood. People tend to think, oh, I wouldn't behave in a certain way if I didn't feel a certain way, but it's actually the opposite, that behaviour can trigger off certain beliefs and certain feelings about allegiance to the group and allegiance to a leader or allegiance to a belief system.
And how do you even begin to shift that when it's really extreme?
Mainly a lot of guilt. Often a lot of phobias are created. The people are told that if they leave the group or they leave the cause, they'll be responsible for terrible things happening to themselves or their family or even to the world itself. But if something changes in what is said, or the belonging to the group is no longer working for someone, then doubt can start to creep in, and then depending on the degree of control the group has to their total life, then they may start to try and think about leaving. The only trouble is that if you've been in those groups for quite a while, leaving can mean that you are literally totally on your own when you leave, and you don't necessarily have the skills or capacity to cope very well, and that tends to keep people in the group.
I woke up the next morning, you know, I thought to myself, oh, Jesus Christ, what happened last night? The guy from Zambia. And I said, shit. I couldn't get that out of my head.
Touré, thanks very much for joining us from Shanghai. You specialise in trying to change extremists and breaking up neo-Nazi groups. How do you even start to change their minds?
Well, usually when they want to leave, or when they start to consider leaving, they are often disillusioned. They felt that leaders were manipulating them, or they found that it was too much excitement. They were too stressful. They started to burn out. So there are many reasons why they want to leave.
Can you change somebody who you get hold of but who might not want to change?
Well, you need at least to have some kind of opening for change. If you just want to remain, there is nothing much you can do. But sometimes you can get through by talking to them, showing them that there is an alternative, that perhaps what they were doing is not doing any good. There are such kind of golden moments when you can get through. But it's better and easier to work with people who are motivated to leave. Then you can have a greater chance to make them really change.
You do most of your work in Norway, and I wonder whether it would include talking to somebody like the right-wing extremist Anders Breivik, who was responsible for killing 77 of your countrymen and women. Is that someone you would talk to and try to change?
Well, I'm actually going to interview him in a few weeks, but I do not have a lot of hope for him because he is very devoted to his ideology.
What would you say to him to see if he could change, to try to shift him?
I'm not going to try to change him at this moment. It could be that a few years on from now, he will be more open to change. But as I've got some letters from him, and I don't think he is in the stage where that is possible. I think it will be a very difficult case.
How difficult is it to change the kind of people in neo-Nazi groups, people like Tom here, how difficult is it to get them to change their beliefs when you first come into contact with them?
Well, he was a really hardcore activist. He was very political, very, very motivated, had a very strong ideology. But there were some moments in his life when he started to have doubts because things were not quite as he expected. And for our relationship is quite special because I was one of those public figures who was on his hit list back in 1997. And now we are very good friends. So he is a fantastic example of the potential to change.
Tom, you were plotting to kill Touré.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Well, for us, the threat on the streets were anti-racist militant activists. But Touré, because he wouldn't go out in the street and fight with us, but he would be able to change how the local authorities were approaching us in a way that would dismantle us. So he was a great threat.
So how far down the track did you go with the plot to kill this man who's now your friend?
Well, we knew where he lived. We knew where he worked. We, of course, knew how he looked. He was on our list, and we were looking for guns.
So what changed for you? What shifted your beliefs away from this group?
One was that I was released from jail in Norway, and the Norwegian right-wing movement was in bad shape. Nelson Mandela was president in South Africa. I was told by my South African colleagues, the people who shared my beliefs, that come to South Africa, it's going to be a civil war here soon, and we need reinforcements, so we need people to come down. So I jumped.
And you turned up in your Nazi uniform.
Oh yeah. I went on the plane to South Africa with a swastika on my arm, and it was some whites, but mainly people of other color. So I didn't feel much comfortable there. I hadn't seen that many colored people in my whole life. So I wanted to go back on the plane, but then, I saw the AWB guys with their armbands and uniforms and they had a license to carry guns. So, I felt safe when I saw them. Mm. So
tell us what happened that shifted your belief.
I had no money for 10 days. I was staying at a youth hostel in Joburg. Again, I only had clothing with swastikas on, so everybody in the youth hostel, they knew that I was a neo-Nazi, so of course nobody wanted to have anything to do with me. But the owner was a sympathizer. She came from Rhodesia, she said, not Zimbabwe. So they left Zimbabwe when Mugabe took power. She let me stay there for free for 10 days. and gave me breakfast. But of course, one meal in 24 hours isn't too much. So one evening I was sitting in a bar watching rugby. I heard a voice next to me saying, two lager, two beers. Somebody gave me a beer and I turned around and it was this black African, not South African, he was from Zambia. And he had a very friendly smile and he gave me that beer. I thought to myself, is he insane? Is he crazy? What's wrong with him? You know, so I turned around like this to show him that I had a swastika T-shirt on me, you know. And he just kept on smiling and said, drink up. Cheers. And I thought to myself, oh, my God, you know, he must be for the Secret Service trying to kill me. It must be rat poison in the beer, you know. And the bartender, you know, he nodded and said, it's okay. You know, it's like they could read my mind. And I was hungry and thirsty, so tired of drinking water. So I took the beer and we got drunk together, me and the guy. I woke up the next morning, you know, I thought to myself, oh, Jesus Christ, what happened last night? And I was thinking, you know, the guy from Zambia. And I said, shit, what happened? You know, I couldn't get that out of my head.
Yeah. Okay, so you now try to change other neo-Nazis. You work with Touré here, the man you plotted to kill, to try to change other neo-Nazis.
Yes.
How do you try to change them?
Sometimes they are not motivated to change, but they are open. Maybe subconsciously they are open to change. But also I come in fairly quickly sometimes because the schools and the municipalities around the country, they are very quick to react. So it was like this one day, it was a kid who showed up at school, 10th grader, with swastika on his back. Backpack, and it was it created a situation at the school and in class.
And what did you say to him? Did you talk about yourself?
Yeah, he asked a lot about me, and I would tell him the brutal honesty, you know, what was good about being a neo-Nazi, but also what was bad and why I changed. And I got through to him by doing that.
Mm. He took the swastika off his back.
Oh, yeah.
Mm. Mohammed, you're trying to de-radicalise Jamaat Islamiyah members who are in prison quite often. How you do that work for the Singaporean government, how do you even start to do that with a violent mindset?
I think first and foremost, government understood that they themselves have to change in terms of their policies, in terms of winning hearts and minds of those people who had gone into extremism and terrorism. So when we talk about Jamaat Islamiyah, it's about religious ideology. So you need religious teachers to understand this because a secular government does not understand.
So you need those connections, those real connections.
Yes, you need real people. So the doors of the prisons were open, family members were met, spouses and children were able to... There is this bridge that was never there before. Suddenly we met human beings who have had this process of indoctrination. It's very interesting today because this kind of terms that they have been using, it's quite similar to what Jamaat Islamiyah members have been using. We were able to hear from God to Satan to monkeys.
Yes.
Within the minds and hearts that have spoken, because that was that process of indoctrination. They had this issue of who to be loyal to, who to be disloyal to.
You're suggesting here that it takes quite a lot of time to do this. And I mean, in a sense, you've got a captive group. You've got a group that are in prison. So what about trying to change the mind, shift the mindset of the people who are out in the community who have those beliefs?
We came to that realization after focusing on the target audience of those who are in prison. And what we do in Singapore is that we have community engagement programs. We meet families who have this tendency to have been introduced to such radical pathways. And then we have programs to those who have not understood this in schools and everywhere else to get others to see the reality of the problem.
Do they have to be willing
to
meet with you, to talk to you? I mean, is that a prerequisite in a way?
I think the interesting thing that happened to me in terms of meeting with Jamaat Islamiyah, there were both cases. There were people who were willing to, and at the same time, Jamaat Islamiyah members themselves, they would want such opportunity to meet people with us, like us, because it's that opportunity to get us to sympathise to their cause.
Yeah, to get to convert you.
Yeah, to convert us to become those who believe in it. And if you get a religious authority to be part of the team, that's more.
So sometimes they meet you thinking they're going to win you over.
That is that opportunity for them.
So how do you even start to change that?
I think first it's about building trust. That's that process. It's not about the ideology. It's not about who you are, who I am. It's about now you see me as that individual. I see you as another person. So that process, building trust, number one. Number two is trying to understand what are those that have made them to become indoctrinated. So what are the concepts? What are the values? What are the lifestyle?
You keep pointing to Tom.
Yeah, because I see so many similarities.
I was wondering about
and
that.
And suddenly we have like become bonded because of this session. So suddenly you understand, you know, you have a brother here that needs that helping hand. And you feel him, you understand that he had felt some bitterness, which you have been safe from not feeling it.
So you present your life as being free of some of the trouble that his life has.
And not comparing it, but understanding it.
Yeah.
Understanding that you have that hand to walk together with to see the light at the end of the tunnel.
Is that what you do too, Tom?
Yeah.
That same thing? Yeah? Yeah, you two are going to have a big chat after this.
Yeah, I know.
I can just tell.
I'm at the same hotel. Yeah.
Greg Barton, you're interested in counterterrorism too, of course, and as well as de-radicalisation. How difficult do you think it is to change a dangerous mindset, a mindset that someone has that where they're bent on violence to achieve their goals?
Well, there are no silver bullets. There are no simple solutions. But if somebody is at a point of opening, and sometimes you can create that opening. When you're in an exclusive group, you think the rest of the world is just mad and bad. If you meet somebody outside your world and they're friendly and they're opening, as Tom was describing, you know that forces you to recalibrate all your beliefs.
And Rose, you're nodding about this too, yes. With your experience. Yeah? That happened to you?
Oh, yeah. The mindset I was under is that the whole world is under the power of the devil. Mm. And I was part of the chosen people that are bringing about... you know, the reign of God. So, yeah.
We focus on mindsets and ideas, but ideas really follow relationships. And relationships are about the group that we belong to, our sense of identity, who we are, and then the ideas sort of reinforce that. So if you can connect with somebody, it's a chance that they might actually reflect on their ideas, particularly if they can see themselves belonging to a broader human community, an outside world that they thought was an enemy, but now it looks friendly.
I'm interested that you said that you look for an opening, and the opening idea has come up with everybody, or you can create one. How can you create an opening?
Well, I think people? Muhammad expressed it very well. If you can connect with them as human beings and they can see that actually you're not really so different from them, that your faith, if questions of religion are important, is also genuine and earnest, but that you're compassionate, empathetic towards them. I think empathy is a key thing to it. Listening to people's stories is key. Mm.
This, of course, is totally at odds with the punitive model that exists in every discussion about, you know, extremist violence or anything else. I mean, you're actually talking about getting to people and not judging them to find a way in to their stories, yeah? Would that be fair summary?
Yeah. Yeah, and some people might say this is a soft approach and be critical for that reason, but if you look at the work that Touré has done for decades or Muhammad has been doing, or now that Tom's engaged with, you can see this is really the only approach that works. Being tough and judging people as being either mad or bad is to recreate the same kind of fundamentalist thinking that gets people into trouble in the first place.
Mm. Rose, why do you think you and your husband joined 12 Tribes? What was the appeal of it?
Well, both my husband and I were idealistic. And also we cared about the state of the world and so many problems and wars, and you just don't have the answers. And then the 12 Tribes had all the answers.
And it was about belonging to something? Did you feel like you wanted a community?
Well, everyone loves to have friends and have a family, and both our families are in different countries, so we don't have that, but Mm. I guess that's one reason, but it's the instability of the world at the moment too. And
I'm interested in this because I'm interested in what people have to leave behind in order to leave behind some of their extremist views. You know, what it means in terms of cutting off from things. And Yeonmi, I know that you had to leave behind 20 family members, didn't you, in North Korea?
Yeah.
Mm. What was that like?
Oh, of course, terrible, yeah. I miss them, but I cannot see them, and I don't know where I can see them again. So,
So that's a big thing to do when you're just 14, yeah?
Yeah. Mm.
How long did it take for you to start thinking differently after you defected?
So, like, when I was in China and then I met some people and they were talk about the how bad he is and that he's the dictator and then he made a, like, a labor camp and then he's a, like, terrible leader. And then I was, like, say bad to them, you know, you cannot say that.
Because you were scared that he would know.
Yeah. Mm. I was, and also I was like, oh, I have to show my loyalty to him so he can see me, even though
I'm
in China.
This is even though you're out.
Yeah, it was even though I was in China. I had to prove that I respect him, you know.
Now, you eventually spent 3 months in Hanawon, mm-hmm. which is a resettlement centre in South Korea. Mm. Dateline's Amos Roberts explains here how it works, how that place works.
After they arrive in South Korea, all defectors are brought here, the Hanawon Resettlement Centre. The government built this place in 1999 in order to deal with the large numbers of defectors who'd started arriving. Security at Hanawon is tight. During their three-month stay here, they're given a crash course on life in the South and equipped with some of the skills they'll need to survive.
Yomi, what was it like in Hanawon for you when you got there?
So basically my dream was like really high and then I had a really big expectation of the South Korea and then it was like boom, you know.
Okay. And you've said also that you felt brainwashed all over again.
Yeah, like that's why I started to think that, okay, I'm a loser. I'm a failure. I cannot do anything here, you know. That is not easy, you know, for you. The South Korean kids, how hard they study, you know, and the competition is really hard, like crazily, like serious, and then you cannot beat them up. And
shi-eun, you're a psychologist and you used to work at Hanawon. You're now an advisor there. What do you think about this description of what goes on at Hanawon? Do you think it is a little bit not sympathetic enough to the plight of North Koreans when they arrive there?
제가 2001년부터 2002년까지 한화원에서 일을 했는데요. 당시에 우리 한국 사람들은 북한 사람들에 대한 이해가 많이 부족했습니다. 왜냐하면 60년 동안 우리 북한 이탈 주민에 대한 이해가 부족했고, 그리고 연미 씨가 말한 한화원에 대한 교육, 한화원에 대한 교육 체계는 우리 남한 사람들이 북한 사람들이 필요하겠다라고 생각해서 이제 만든 체계입니다.
What do you focus now on trying to change when you come into contact with North Korean defectors?
지금은 탈북자의 교육을 위해서 하나원에서는 자본주의, 민주주의, 그리고 남한 사회에서 살 수 있는 문화 적응 프로그램, 그리고 북한과 중국에서 겪은 그런 트라우마를 좀 해소할 수 있는 그런 집단 상담과 개인 상담을 하고 있습니다.
And what are the hardest things to change, to shift?
그들은 북한에서부터 가지고 있었던 생각이 있는데 가장 첫 번째로 이제 다른 사람들을 의심한다거나 나를 이해하고 타인을 이해하고 대인관계를 어떤 신뢰관계에서 유지를 하고 대화를 하는지 그 어려워하고 있습니다. 그리고 또한 남한 사회에서 어떻게 경쟁을 할까, 남한 사회에서 성공할 수 있을까, 내가 어떤 직업을 찾을까, 그리고 북한에서 만나지 못한 가족에 대한 그리움을 가지고 있을 때 그것들을 어떻게 스트레스를 해소할까, 이런 우울감을 어떻게 해소할까, 그런 것들에 대해서 포커스하고 있습니다.
Do you think that's a fair description? Do you think that you were suspicious of other people when you arrived, Yeonmi?
I think that is really right, I think.
So how hard was it for you to shift that thinking, that belief that Kim Jong-il could listen to everything that you thought, could hear, understand your mind? How long did it take for you to let go of that, to see that that wasn't true?
First of all, I had to believe that he's dying. No, he can die, you know, because when I was in North Korea, they always say he's like, his life is forever, everlasting. So he's not dying at all, and then he's watching us just like every day. And so that's why I had to accept him as a human. So follow that, I can see that, oh, he's died. So, and yeah, just for me, it was like, I changed my mind. It was like, it took like 3 years.
And 3 years to shift.
Yeah, and I got to just South Korea, and then, like, I changed totally, like, being a South Korean, the mindset. So,
I. And what changed you? What do you think changed you?
Actually, I could not. Yeah, I read lots of books at that time, and then the one book was like the Animal Farms.
Animal Farm.
Yes.
Fantastic choice. That was, what a great choice.
Yeah, so I read that book, and I was like crying whole night. After that book, just my mind changed like totally.
Yeah. George Orwell would be so thrilled, so thrilled. Rose, your husband wanted to get you all out of 12 tribes, but he didn't tell you he was planning to do it, did he? Why?
Well, because I would have told the leaders straight away.
You would have told the leader.
That my husband has lost his faith, so being a good brainwashed wife that I was, thinking that
I'm. You would have dobbed on him.
Yeah, I would have said he's like faith, and they wouldn't have sent me to visit him.
Raphael Aaron, you describe yourself as an exit counsellor. Now, you'd been planning this intervention for years after being contacted by Rose's family. What did you do? How did you get them out?
What we decided to do was to take Matthew on my right as a key person, having been a former member of that organisation, to be able to establish a bridge of trust with Rose and with her family.
Because he'd been in the organisation.
He'd been there, and Matthew and I have worked together for many years, and I was reasonably well known in the area, and therefore if I would show up my face, then that would work against me and against Rose. So Matthew and I worked very closely together, and together with Rose's sister, in order to put together a plan which would eventually mean that she could leave the organisation. And that plan was executed in New Zealand.
And that was by getting them away from the place here to New Zealand, and then you moved in.
And one of the primary.
Fortunately, Mark had been sent away because their eldest son wasn't.
This is Rose's husband.
Rose's husband.
Who didn't want to be here tonight, by the way. Yep.
Yeah. He was not a model child for the 12 tribes, so they sent Mark away with his son. And that gave me the opportunity to go and start working on Mark, because I was very good friends with them when we were in the 12 tribes together. And although Rose says she never had any doubts, I used to watch her suffer greatly at the hands of everyone around us. And I was very, very concerned for their son as well. And when Raphael contacted me, I was just more than happy to help. So Mark.
Okay, so you devised a situation where they were all in New Zealand.
Yes.
Now, you used your then 14-year-old daughter, sitting next to you here, who's no longer 14, in that intervention. Why did you use her when she was only 14?
For Tessa to turn up, it just broke down the barriers. And they
so you were the first person who turned up, Tessa. What was that like for you at 14, though, to do something like that?
Well, Dad had asked me about it previously, like, he's like, we're going to New Zealand to help a family. Like, I briefly remembered them, and I was like,
because you'd been in 12 tribes too until you were five, I think.
Six. When he asked me about it, I was like, yes, like, I want to do everything I can to help them, because I know that me leaving, like, I was just so grateful for it, and I was like, man, if I can give that opportunity to them, like, yes, I will go.
So you were the first port of call person who went in and tried to convince them to leave.
It was kind of, well, I was sort of there to sort of diffuse the tension, I guess, because they were kind of scared of my dad. Like, they'd heard stories from the elders of him being violent and, you know, everything. Like, there was a tension.
Because he'd left?
Because he'd left, and because there'd been other sort of minor incidents that I guess had kind of been embellish.
Rose, what convinced you to leave?
Oh, it's a huge process, but for me, the crack in my mind control was that I realised that the leaders thought really bad of me. It was over time. It took me a few months, but I started thinking, well, God doesn't see me like that. And I still thought they hadn't made me feel so bad about myself that I thought I was totally bad. You know, I still had some self-esteem, and I thought, well, no, I'm not like that. They've got a problem. They've got a problem, you know, and that
okay,
created
so that
a crack.
Okay, so that was where the crack started. That was what started you to decide to leave.
Yeah, but it's not until I was physically out, when I was in New Zealand, when you're physically out, you do have a chance for that mind control to break. Mm.
Okay. Yeah. Raphael, you say you're proponents of mind control. What do you mean by that with what you do?
It's a very controversial area as to whether mind control really exists, and I happen to be a believer in that concept, in that minds can be controlled by people and other forces outside the individual.
You fight mind control with mind control?
No, absolutely not. The whole idea of exit counselling is to bring people back to where they were in the first instance, and not to impose or to put upon them any particular views. And I think it's really, really important. It has no religious content. It has no persuasive content in that respect. It's simply a matter to be able to bring people back to where they were. That's often complicated by the fact that today we are seeing a lot of people who are second-generation cult members, so there's no place to bring them back to because they were never out of a cult.
But are you dealing with unwilling people when you stage interventions? I mean, we've heard earlier about people needing, you know, there needs to be a certain amount of willingness. Are you dealing with unwilling people quite often?
Essentially, yes, because nobody's going to invite you in to have them exit counselled. So what you've got to do is devise a strategy by which you can engage with that particular person.
Louise, can I just ask you briefly what you think of this exit counselling?
Well, as a psychologist, of course, there's all sorts of ethical issues surrounding that that would mean that I wouldn't be involved in that kind of a process. I think there's also, my concern is that there often isn't a good understanding of some of the psychological problems that people can have when they're leaving these organisations. And I have certainly seen people who have left these groups, sometimes by outside intervention, where they actually have quite significant dissociative disorders.
Okay, so you think this is dangerous? You think this type of thing can be dangerous?
Potentially, if people are not aware and don't know how to recognise dissociation and some of the other problems that people have, and even skilled professionals often have difficulty recognising dissociation in their consulting rooms in a controlled environment, then yes, it can be potentially very dangerous.
Raphael, can I get a response briefly from you about this? People are highly vulnerable in these situations. I'm just wondering what qualifications you have.
Well, I think it's really important when you talk about this area that you're not working in isolation, you're working as a part of a team. So you've got people, for example, who may be psychologists or social workers or psychiatrists who are going to be involved in the process. None of us work in isolation. We actually work as facilitators rather than one man or one woman shows, which means that all the issues...
So you're saying that there's psychologists and psychiatrists actually present, Raphael?
We would say that we consult with psychologists and psychiatrists all along the way. We make sure that we are...
But are they present at that initial meeting?
No, they're
not. Let him answer, Louise.
No, they're not present at the initial meeting, but let's understand what happens at that initial meeting. As Tessa said, it's basically an exchange of ideas, it's an exchange of experiences. Matthew would have talked about what happened during the time that he was in the 12 tribes and what that did to him and how it impacted on him.
Your eldest daughter, Andila, went back to 12 tribes. Do you think you will see her again?
No, I'm not allowed on the premises, and she says she's never going to come visit, so... Yeah.
Yeonmi, you appear on a weekly South Korean variety show. Here's a clip of you talking about your sister, who you lost track of in China when you both defected from North Korea.
정연 찾으려고 정말 간절히 마음 먹고 나왔는데 정말 언니가 이 영상을 꼭 봤으면 좋겠어. 그리고 어디 있든지 이러지 말고 당당하게 잘 살아있어. 언니 영상 여기 있으니까 잊지 말고 정말
That was a year and a half ago. What's happened since?
Yeah, basically 2007, I left North Korea with my mom and my father, without my sister.
And where is she now?
She's in South Korea now. She's with us now. Yeah, just I found out that she was lived in China for 7 years. And then she just got to South Korea last December. So I met her at that time. So it was like a miracle for me. So, yeah.
And how is she? She's just been released from Hanawon, from the resettlement center.
3 days ago.
2 days ago?
3 days ago.
3 days ago.
Yes.
Okay, how is she?
She's very great now. Yeah, she was very very disappointed or psychology, depression on her because she heard that South Korean is really, competition is really high and then the study is really hard and then she was like, oh, I want to go back to China. So we were really worried about her. And yeah.
So how is she? Does she still have those fears that you don't have anymore?
Yeah, actually, I was trying to get her to own studio and then, do this
together. To come and join you here.
Yeah, but just she's still believing that Kim family, they got a power. So if she says something wrong about them, she can be, affected
Worried that if she came on this program with you, she could get into trouble from the Kim family.
Yes, so she's worried about that a lot. And
shi-eun, when people leave Hanawon, how do they find life in South Korea, do you think? What are the difficulties in adjusting?
처음에 이제 가족 관계 문제입니다. 두 번째는 이제 경제적인 문제 또는 이제 학업의 문제입니다. 탈북 청소년 같은 경우에는 학업에 대한 높은 이제 연미 씨도 얘기한 것처럼 높은 경쟁률 그리고 세 번째 이슈는 문화적 적응 문제입니다. 남북한 사람들이 서로 다른 문화에서 성장했기 때문에 어떻게 의사소통을 해야 되는지, 어떻게 관계를 맺어야지 신뢰로운 관계가 되는지 남북한 주민들이 서로 모르기 때문에 문화 적응 이슈에서 우리 탈북민들이 문화 적응 문제에서 굉장히 어려워하고 있고 문화 적응 때문에 남북한 주민 그리고 어떻게 대인 관계를 해야 되는지 문화 적응 문제로 인해서 대인 관계도 어려워하고 있습니다.
Ture, what if you change the behavior of a violent extremist but not their beliefs? Does it matter?
Well, I think sometimes there are people who just quit their involvement in violence but may maintain some militant and radical beliefs. But as long as they don't act on those beliefs, that is not so dangerous. So. But there is, of course, a risk that they may re-engage, go back, and that is a problem with some of these people who have been involved in terrorism, for example.
Ture, how can you be sure that any change is lasting?
Well, we can see that both in the change of lifestyle and the way they behave, I think that's what we can see. I think time is important, building new social relationships, establishing a new life. That is something which is tying people who have been involved in extremist groups, tying them to a normal life and a normal social relations, getting a family, getting a job. That is something which is tying them back to normal life.
Mohammed, you were nodding about that. Those connections. Yeah?
I think this is the time for us to realize the reality of extremism today. And for those who are in the midst of joining such group, extreme groups, they need to understand that that is not the path that they want for their life. So if we do realize this as a parent, as a father, as a mother, as a brother, as a friend, and you see changes in your friends at home, you have a role to play. You need to talk to them. You need to bring books like Animal Farm for people to read. It's about understanding that everybody has a role to play and also expanding the horizon and believing for love to overcome hatred.
And has love overcome hatred for you, Ture, in terms of this man here who plotted to kill you? I mean, how do you feel about him now?
Now, Tom and I are very good friends. We work together in some ways. We have had a good relationship for a few years.
Tom, how different are you now to that neo-Nazi with a Glock pistol?
Well, back in 2002, I was speaking a lot about my past in various universities and other places. At the time, I felt I was talking about myself and my development. But then, as some time passed on, I was talking, and I felt I was talking about another person. Today, I have. It's not like I'm seeing myself. It's like I'm talking about somebody else. It's hard to explain.
Yeon Mi, and do you feel different, like a different person now?
Yeah, I feel like this is true me. And that was a lie, you know, so yeah, it's a different person, definitely different, yeah.
Rose, your eldest daughter, Andila, went back to 12 tribes and you're effectively out of contact with her now. I think we've got a picture here of her and your grandchild, and you took that photo, yeah, but you're not in contact with them regularly.
Yeah, that's the second to last time I saw her and her husband.
Do you think you will see her again?
No. Well, she doesn't live very far, but I'm not allowed on the premises, and she said she's never going to come visit, so... Yeah.
And how are you two now?
Oh, I can have a friendship with my mum and my parents now. Like, I wouldn't be able to back then. So, yeah, it's good.
So we do have to wrap up here now, but I do want to thank everybody very much for joining us tonight. It's been really fascinating. And that is all we can talk about here, but you can keep talking, of course, on Twitter and Facebook. We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. It was great.